Along with the timeline, there's a question: why didn't the RZA manage you? Was that ever a question?
Oh God, he could never have managed me. Like he when they be talking about the de facto leader .. these phrases that they coin him as, these are legitimate, statements to his management of his people, like his life, not just his life, his children, his the family that he feels responsible for, and then the business and the brothers and blah, 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 you know what I mean? Like there was no way, it was never even a thought in my mind to
Right.
even desire something like that, because I knew that I needed something hyper focused on myself.
So what was the initial discussion as far as solo album? Were you supposed to drop at a certain time of this? Like no, you say Ghost and Kappa are also on Razor Sharp as well as yourself. Were you supposed to be in front right after
Yes.
anywhere in this?
Yes. And what happened was, I know we had lost some music. That was also a setback because we had lost some music of mine from a record. I should have come not too long after Iron Man dropped. Was supposed to be in that same window of Iron Man. No go. Yeah.
Is frustration sinking in, or are you just going with the flow at this point?
I'm going with the flow. I'm going with the flow because for me, if I don't got the song, I don't need to release the record anyway, And if we lost some material, now that was hard because it's almost like losing notebooks, Because once they're gone, it's like you can't remember every fucking thing you wrote down.
Right.
So I think I wasn't quite frustrated only because I'm always looking at what can I do to change the scenario? Like, what is it that I can be doing differently to get the outcome that I want? So, all right, cool. Move around. Like, you gotta start moving around. Like, go connect with some other folks. Go do this. Go do that. Which is what I did. I'm working with Armand Van Helden was a producer that I work with, a house producer I work with. So right around this same era when Prana was on her way, I started working with him and really starting to understand. Oh, I can just literally do this all year long. Pick like X amount of months of the year that I want to work. Stack up, and then that's what I'll live off of for the year. You know what I'm saying? Like,
Right.
that's what you're gonna have to do, And then still staying in the creative space because it's kind of difficult when you're running your own show that way, to find out how to fine-tune what you need as far as like a management team or an infrastructure, your business infrastructure, because that's a whole separate thing compared to the creative. Oh, and I get to actually sit down and do the fun part. So,
Right.
in the old days, I was all about the creative. I didn't spend so much time focusing on the infrastructure because I don't trust people. So, it takes me a really long time. So, it wasn't until after Prana was born and I started to kind of spend more time because I obviously her my attention is towards her that I had to go, what does this really look like? What is the business that I'm trying to shape out of this music? How does the music support the business? Not the other way around. How does the music support the business? So I can spend those wonderful creative time that I have. I'm doing that knowing that it's supporting a structure that I will have to just slowly build, that I will have to acknowledge that I'm a person that takes time to trust people, but I can't do this without support. I cannot do this without the intelligence of seasoned people who understand hip hop, who understand house, who understand global music, who understand pop, who understand everything that I'm capable of doing. And then I have to shoot the vision to them so that they can be clear on what's going on. And then we devise a plan and a strategy to execute. And then the creative part just slips in like a puzzle piece. But
Right.
I didn't get to understanding that until, I don't know, Prana might have been 4 years old. That's when I was like, oh shit, I've been doing this shit backwards the whole time. But not even backwards. I had to do it this way. Because I really needed that time to just nurture the creative. I didn't have any artists around me, but once I got with the clan, that's when I had artists around me. I didn't know no, like hella know no rappers or no singers. Still
Right.
barely know, but only a few singers. So I didn't have anybody like mentoring me in the space of how to get what I needed. It didn't come until much later.
You got super busy in 98. We're going to jump to some of the highlights of your discography in a moment. Was the Wu-Tang Forever your first time on tour?
Yes. Yeah.
And just give us a brief, some of your best memories, and of course, ODB memory.
Oh, well, you know, tour memories I love only because the getting to see an actual reaction from somebody who's been listening to your music for, you know, however long, and sing, and having watching them sing the words to something you wrote. That to me never gets old. I'm just like, how the hell, really? You in Croatia, like, or Bulgaria, or fucking Switzerland? Motherfucker, you listening to this shit? Like, that was dope. That was a highlight. But one of my favorite memories of Dirty, though, Dirty used to pull me to the side often, if not regularly, to tell me that he could see that I was holding back, that I was not, I wasn't really letting go, you know? And again, I'm sure he was seeing the trust thing, you know, the walls that I was putting up. And he was like, you know, you the shit. He was like, I don't understand. Like, let these motherfuckers know who you are. Like, don't you, he said, if I'm their father, you their mother. You know, that was my favorite memory. Dirt, bro. We was, and it was cold as hell outside. We were outside at the Wu Mansion at RZA's house and studio, and he just sat me down out there in the cold, and I was like, I am freezing. I want to go inside. He was like, no, I'm sorry. Like, you gonna have to hear this shit. He was like, enough, man. Like, enough. Like, let these motherfuckers know who you are. You be kind of hiding in the cut. You be acting like you ain't dope. Like, you dope. Like, let them know. And that particular day, I feel like he crashed a couple cars that same day too, actually. Now that I think about it. That might have been a wild weekend at the house. But that's one of my favorite, all of my favorite memories around Dirty are around him telling me things that I didn't think anybody was seeing. And very, very few of them brothers will, you know, Master Kill is another one who does that as well, where he'll look through a nigga, like, Takitha, stop. Meth did the same thing too. One time we were leaving the studio, we were leaving the Hit Factory, and I had just recorded, I had just did All I Got Is You, I think. And we get in the car, as Meth is on the right side of me, and Ghost is in the front seat, and I can't remember who was over here to the left of me. And it was about 5 a.m, because, you know, studio, we probably started recording at 11 o'clock, 10 o'clock at night. So now it's like, it's a Sunday morning. I remember that as well. The sun was like, you know, what they call that, dawn, like pre-dawnish, you know? And we're in the middle of Manhattan, so there's nothing but these, they look like hallways. Like the streets look like hallways and shit. That's all I can remember. And as we were pulling off, I was just like thinking to myself, what in the hell are you doing here? And then Meth gonna rig me with his elbow and go, you know you're supposed to be here, right? You good. You supposed to be here. We got you. Don't worry about it. You good. And I'm thinking, this nigga, are you telepathic? Get out of my damn dome. Like, these are my favorite Wu-Tang memories. They're not about the fucking parties and shows and, you know, for me, my favorite Wu-Tang memories are being seen. Because They say things that people do not, and whether people are afraid to say it or they're just not conscious, they're just not awake, you know. And I'm the person who says it, you know what I mean. So it right. was almost like coming finding your family. Like I found my tribe in Wu-Tang, and I fucked right. with them the long way. So those are my favorite memories.
Very dope. Like I said, you got super busy in 98. I'm gonna highlight some of the favorites from Wu-Tang fans around the world, and you can just give us a brief best memory.
Okay. Come on, you can't be mad at some Killer Priest. You already know how Killer Priest sounds. Like Killer Priest, they get word on the street.
I can't push it.
I know. It's okay. No, Priest. Okay, my. I have a memory about that. When he asked me to do that record. Well, I love working with Priest. By the way, he is a scientist. He is a prolific in many more ways than one. And when he knew he was going to shoot a video for the song, I had already recorded it. Blah blah blah. Let me simple hook. And he was like, "Yeah, I'm gonna shoot it down in Miami." And when we came down for the video shoot, when I tell you, that was probably the best weekend I had ever had. I had only been to Miami like maybe twice at that point. And I could see I could see my big giant afro, my little puff. I was so young. I was so young, but the video itself was super dope. And he was just looking, he's African, he's Asiatic, like he's raw, live, uncut, like, and spitting so much intellectualism. That's what I love about Priest, to even to the present day, because these projects he's been dropping this year and last year during COVID, put on your thinking cap, you know, have a cup right. of tea or something, because you're gonna need something to catch up what he's talking about. But this to me is like just a sliver of the greatness that is experienced when you get to hang out with a man like him. Like Killer Priest is the truth. One of my favorite right. MCs of all time, one of my favorite poets, and a philosopher, an intellect, a scientist. Like, I love everything about that song. One Step is my shit. I love it.
Very dope. We've highlighted a lot of your singing, but let's highlight some MCing. You jumped on the pillar. Capadonna in 98, as well as Black Boy, where you sang. But let's jump into Pump Your Fist.
Oh, snap. Cannot. Oh my god, that was back when I had a lot of energy. That's what has changed over 25 years. Holy shit, girlfriend gotta pop a vitamin or two. That's what I had a lot of energy. I love that. I'm not mad at that song either. Oh my god, I haven't thought about that one in dumb long. Pump up your fist, pump up your fist, and you bloody shit,
right?
Young Cap.
You also jumped on Law of the Dark Man's Heist of the Century with Street Life.
Oh, forgot about that one too.
Take us back. Oh yeah. Take us back.
Street Life. Let's see. God, where did we record that? We probably recorded that at the mansion too. We did a lot of records out there. Law is again another, you know, Law now, he wears a lot of hats. A lot of Dark Man is a serious dude, but I always like messing with him too, because I like the storytelling. You know, I come from a place where these stories are important, and I hate to be on some of the games to be sold not told, because some of the things that I really be wanting to talk about, I grew up in a culture where you don't talk about those things person to person. Right. You can put them in a song, but you right. know, but yeah, Street Life was a good record. I like that record. We recorded in New York, same with all the others. I think I've only ever recorded outside of New York and LA with the Clan, and that was for forever. And then for that album, the one that got A Better Tomorrow, I recorded in LA for A Better Tomorrow too. But anyway, yeah, it's not that. I forgot about that one too. Dang, you digging up some things.
98.
I did my own homework.
You jumped on Bobby Digital's album, The RZA. What was the discussion? I think he kind of caught us Wu-Tang fans off with this album. What do you remember the most about going into this project?
First of all, okay, me and Bobby Digital, I love Bob Digi, but my God, that is a wild, wild boy, man. That was a wild boy. I might have checked out a little bit during that time. I've been like, you know what? I'm gonna let you have this one. I love that during that season, I got to see and it's the only way I can describe this is like an unbridled RZA, you know, who's gonna do whatever the fuck he wanna do, and that's creatively and every way else, you know.
Right.
And so that it was kind of inspiring for a person like myself who's buttoned up, you know. I can be very boxed in my thinking, so I have a fondness for Bobby Digital, but I prefer Rakim Allah, me myself.
Right. You jumped on the track Mantis. I'm gonna play a little snippet of that, take us back a little bit.
It's too much. I'm so young. Listen to my little voice. Oh my God. I'm so cooled out now. You have no idea. It's like I barely like to raise my voice these days. You it's gonna take a lot for you to get me to raise my voice. Yelling and shit? No.
Yeah, you were hella busy in 98.
Listen, how'd it be like? Needed the bag? Like, hello? You need me to feature on what? I'll be there. Show up on time, water in hand, ready to go.
Right.
Good time.
You talked a little bit about Soul in the Hole already, as mm-hmm. well as getting with Armand for his project. Mm-hmm. Let me just run through a few other people and you can just give me some highlights. Shaheen Manchild.
Oh, that was a good one too. That's baby bro right there. Shaheen, that project, when he asked me if I would feature on the record and we played it, I feel like he had his verses done too by the time I got to it. And that song was really special to me as well, because I have a love for him and a fondness, like, as a big sister, you know. And he again is another one, like, we deep over there with Intellects, man. Like, these guys, they're not run of the mill, you know. And they have a lot of passion, a lot of pride as well. I have to get a charger. A lot of passion, a lot of pride, but I feel humbled, you know, by being asked, even by Shaheen, incredibly talented, and him saying like, oh sis, I need you to get on this record for me. And all I could think about when I think about him, and I think about the life that he has had to live since he was a boy, like a young boy, younger than when we did that record. The fact that he's alive, to me, is a blessing, you know, to us, you know, and to see his evolution even from prior to us doing that record to when we did the record, and then a lot of the things that have happened with him post that to the present day, as I feel honored that I share that little piece of musical history with him that really, to me, defines who he is, like, man child in the promised land. Who understands? Like, who really understands, dude? Like, right. Who really understands, dude? And I know he got family, he got friends, so I know somebody does. But right. That's to me what I felt like in the song was I wanted people to kind of try to get a glimpse of how important and how powerful and how special and unique this brother is, even though you might see him one way. You know, see, you know, I don't like the idea of people being viewed one-dimensionally. It annoys me, you know. Right. And especially where my peers are concerned, these brothers that I do work with and who who hold me down, who I hold them down. I feel like that's my job as a creative partner to them, is to make sure that I am bringing awareness to who they are, so that they're not being seen as these one-dimensional characters that society tries to paint them out to be. So that's kind of what Man-Child meant to me. Everything I write right. is not, even if it might be the simplest impossible you can ever figure out, I really be meaning what I'm saying, you know, every word, literally.
Right.
Yeah.
I think Walking Through Darkness appeared on the Ghost Dog soundtrack, as well as Ghostface Killah's album. What's the origins behind Walking Through Darkness?
Walking Through the Darkness. Originally I wrote Walking Through the Darkness for my album, and Ghost liked it, and RZA loved it. And then that's how it ended up kind of getting like, well, wait a minute, let's give it some life. Like, we can't just have it like getting, you know, stuck in a shelf, you know, let's just go ahead and put some life to it. So I was happy about that one too. I was really surprised at how people felt about that record as well. And again, same kind of thing, you know, they can't see him walking through the darkness. Like the world, the society we live in, like a lot of my stories are really for black men. If you really,
right.
Just to keep it a book. And so if you see, but how to it's been so long since he had a true friends are sure hard to come by. Like, that's real shit. Like, and then again, his loyalty lies within, always kept his head to the sky. You know, these are, and I know these guys, like, and I'm not talking about the Klan. I'm talking about, I know 100,000 of them kind of brothers where it's like, he can't trust nobody. He's walking through this shit alone, but he's trying to keep his head up. He's trying to, like, you know, hold his stature. But where is people at? And he's loyal to himself because he can't trust nobody else. That's why he's loyal to himself first. So, you know, just a little. This is how I see my friends and family, and I'm trying to, through song, acknowledge them, like, let them know, hey, I see you, and I got you, though, the best I can to support you, at least by acknowledging that I see what you're going through from your perspective, not just mine.
Right.
Yeah.
You also